Welcome back to the Pursuit Podcast. We had such a great time talking with Tanya about her experience getting into tech without a degree that we wanted to come back and profile some other people who've gotten into tech without computer science degrees. So I'm Jessica Rose, and today I'm here with...
Hi, I'm Thayer Prime. I run Team Prime Consulting and also got into tech without a degree.
So how'd that work for you?
Yeah, I mean, I've loved computers since I was really little. I sort of took my first one apart at 8 and almost managed to rebuild it, which was quite upsetting to my parents when I couldn't quite manage. And then I've been programming really since about 12, 13. But I found academia kind of hard work, like not as in the school stuff. I find that quite easy, but the actual kind of social environment of it. And also I was brought up abroad, so I had to pay for my own schooling when I came back to the UK, and I just generally couldn't afford it. So yeah, that's why I didn't get a degree, is the kind of quick story around that. But I knew technology was what I wanted to work in. It was super important.
And I think that cost of a computer science degree is something that can really make it challenging for people to get one, even folks who might really want to go to the degree route. So how do you get in without going for an expensive computer science degree?
Yeah. And just before I go on to that, there is a thing around the costing as well, because it's not just the cost of the degree, it's the cost of not earning and the cost of having to pay your own way. I've actually lived on my own since I was 16. And so having bills to pay just meant that education wasn't particularly an option. I know for some people it can be. My husband, for example, took out big loans, which he only finished paying off about 15 years after he'd finish university, but I just didn't see that as an option. So yeah, there's two costs. There's the actual cost of paying for the education, and then there's the actual cost of not earning. And I think that's really important, because I think most people presume you live with your parents until you're, you know, mid-20s these days, and that's just not the case for quite a lot of people. But yeah, how to get around that boundary of getting into technology without a degree is really interesting, because quite a few people, I applied to MI5 and Google when I was 18 and developing, and both of them turned me down without any, you know, review of my application, just because I didn't have a degree. And it really left a terrible taste in my mouth with both places. It was a real shame. I found that networking was great. Those who know me will know that I enjoy a good party, and I love dancing and DJing. And actually, I met a DJ friend who also programmed and was working in the first.com in London. And he sort of said, oh, well, if you program, come and work for us. You know, we'll just take you on. Because back then, I don't know now, but it felt like it was easier. I mean, I'm old now, I'm 37. But back then I was like 19, it was the first.com boom. And basically, so long as you could string together some HTML, people would generally hire you. I'm not entirely sure these days that it's as easy. I've seen a lot of people coming out of things like Makers Academy or other places and just really not finding jobs for a very long time.
So that's really interesting. I'm actually mentoring someone with a bootcamp degree at the moment. And actually, my husband's just graduated from a bootcamp. And it's one of those things where I can't really tell if it's my sample set, but it does seem to be rather challenging to get your first job after a bootcamp. Although it does seem to be quite a bit more challenging if you don't look like what people stereotypically associate with a programmer.
Do you mean physically, or do you mean as in with experience?
I think both. I see more from people of color and women that there's a real challenge to getting in without a degree and getting in with bootcamp experience. And it may be that my husband's piggybacking off my network a bit, but he seems to have had a really comfortable time getting interviews and having these discussions.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I was out with a guy the other night who was black, and he changed his name from his African name to, I believe it was something like John Briggs or John something. Anyway, a very traditional English name. And he, after not being hired for 6 months, was hired within 2 weeks.
A really dear friend of mine in the States moved from a very, very traditionally Chinese name to Barry, and he's very comfortable in his new job.
Yeah, it's a really weird thing. But I think, so it is hard to get into it, but I think the compounding thing as well is that certainly with a lot of the jobs I do in recruitment, people are often hiring for senior only. And even when they're not, even when they're hiring for sort of mid-level or junior, they're expecting quite a lot of bang for their buck, so quite a lot of experience. I think, you know, a degree does help, because you do a lot of computer work on the actual degree. So you're already popping out the other end with some demonstrable experience, which I think is really helpful. And you tend to learn how to code in a way that's a lot more easy to understand, if that makes sense. So when I was learning to code and teaching myself, some of the constructs I really struggled with was stuff I would have learned on a degree, but it's not stuff you'd necessarily self-teach, like around how computers work, for example. I never bothered to worry about that too much. I just liked hacking. Whereas actually when you get into sort of deep development around memory stuff and scaling and all sorts of interesting stuff around databases and how they work, actually understanding how computers work and store data themselves can really help you unpick some of the code I found. That was a bit of a blocker for me.
This is actually a point I find really interesting. I think that in adult education for computer science, and especially for free and online learning platforms, we do a lot of work on zero to beginner level. So here are the fundamentals of how to program. Here's how a database works in very, very easy terms. But we don't really have any way for people who've learned either via bootcamp or by self-teaching to really fill in some of those more professionalized working patterns and to fill in some of the theory that underpins what we're working on.
Yeah, I think it's a really good point. And for me, I really wish companies would take this on and use this as part of mentoring. I know some do, but it does seem to be quite few and far between. I think there should be a lot more of development paths and a lot more responsibility in the industry to actually grow our own talent. And people, when I bring this up with them, are always quite nervous that if they do that, then they'll invest a lot of money and people will leave. And I'm like, well, you know, the thing is that if you don't grow your own, then you're not going to find them. But also if they want to leave, it's not because of anything that you could change it up.
Statistically, they're leaving anyway. So the turnover here in the UK is what, 18, 24 months?
Yeah, that's about right. I mean, that's when I would start hunting people. Usually at that stage, but it can be even less still. But, you know, create a company where people want to work, where people want to stay, mentor people. I mean, I've worked with some companies. There's a great company called MillerHare, who are a really cool technical architectural company. Ooh. And, you know, they grow their own. They're well worth looking at. Because they have some really interesting tech that straddles a whole bunch of different languages. And they basically make stuff up as they go along because they're really like groundbreaking in the sort of technologies they use. And people stay there for ages. You know, their average kind of lifespan there is 10, 15 years. So it can be done. It's a thing. It's just, I think that people tend to move too fast and they're very accepting that people move on after 2 years. And it just doesn't need to be like that at all.
And one of the things I hear again and again from people who are leaving their jobs, and I imagine you hear this in recruitment, when you ask, why are you moving on? One of the most common things I hear is, I wasn't really learning anything.
Yeah, that's quite common. Money's usually quite a big one. People don't feel like they can get pay rises if they stay put. Whereas if you move, you're pretty much guaranteed to get a 2 or 5 grand pay rise. So, you know, obviously if you're moving every couple of years, then that means you're going to go up, you know, in pay quite quickly. Whereas if you stay in a company, they don't often do pay rises. I've found not recently, I've not really heard of anybody who went, yeah, I'm really well paid. Just doesn't seem to happen.
That's always seemed really short-sighted to me.
Yeah,
there's additional costs with hiring. There's additional costs with onboarding. There's even additional costs with people leaving and doing the wrap-up paperwork.
Yeah,
making sure that you're paying people according to the market and keeping them in seems like a no-brainer. But
it is, and I think most companies understand that. However, a bit like recruitment, everyone knows they should be doing a best job, but it's always somebody else's job. And there's never often somebody dedicated in the company to look after it. Even when you have internal recruiters or HR people, the rest of their day job is usually around other things. People still don't take this seriously as part of what a actual job should be doing, which is looking after staff, looking after staff happiness, and making sure that, you know, you don't have a revolving door. I always say to my clients, the worst thing you ever want is to hire someone and they leave within 6 months. And so that's why really decent interviewing processes are important. But trying to get it somewhere where you're not putting people off, especially, you know, people in minorities who may feel nervous around very long or very awkward interview process, we don't want to put them off. But on the other hand, we also want to make sure that we're screening people enough that we know they're going to stay and that we can offer them opportunities that they're going to enjoy in 2-3 years time, not just for the next 12 months.
This is something that's really interesting to me, and I hope we're not going off topic too much. But designing interview experiences and screening experiences that really take on the different communication patterns, especially of underrepresented folks. So whenever I counsel people going into an interview or looking to get jobs, I always tell them to go into an interview and be as obnoxiously American as possible.
Oh, God.
It's the only time I give that advice. Because Americans, we tend to be very, oh, I did this and it was great and I'm amazing and not terribly shy.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas traditional communication patterns, especially for women, for example, you tend to see women talking about achievements as, well, you know, we did this as a group. I was really lucky to be working with this person, this person, this person.
Yeah. I see where you're coming from. It's an interesting approach. Yes, I think that would work really well for people who can be like that. Like, I suspect me and you are that kind of person. But for a lot of people, they're already nervous anyway. And the idea of trying to put on a persona that doesn't sit comfortably with them would probably make them even more nervous, I would find. So I think there's two threads to this. So with clients I work with who are hiring, I always say to them, I know this sounds odd, but what you need to do is make the candidate feel as comfortable as possible. That might mean looking at where they sit in the room. So when they come in, they're always facing the door or have a door in view so they know that there's a way out. Like don't sit them behind a door and stuff like that. But also how many people are in front of them, where you sit on the table, making sure that things like the language that you use, the smiling on your face, if they trip up, just immediately helping them with that and moving on to something else. Always focusing on people's achievements and things they've done well and asking them about good things. And even if it's you want to ask about a time that they've dealt with a problem, just, you know, make sure that it's framed and phrased in a very positive light. You know, hey, what problems have you come up against? What did you do to achieve, you know, solving them? So rather than saying, what's the worst thing you've ever worked on? So because you'll get more out of them from doing that and you'll help them to have a better interview and you'll see the real person. And for people going in, I always say to them, just be yourself. Remember that at the end of the day, if they're going to hire you for you, that's really the most important thing you could want. So interview them back, but don't be too pushy. Just like treat it as if you're chatting to a friend. And also try not to just worry about it too much, you know, because if it doesn't work out, then it wasn't right for you, but it wasn't anything that you did wrong. Try and go in and, you know, expect this as you interviewing them just as much as they're interviewing you, kind of shift the power balance. So it's not you trying to impress them, but it's also, you know, you should be looking for cues from them about why should you want to go and work there. I think that's really important.
That's fantastic advice. And I do so much work one-on-one with people looking for work or looking for a better job. And I'm always really frustrated that it doesn't seem like employers are doing very much work to better understand and better shape interview processes. So it's fantastic to hear that you've got clients who are doing this.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm very lucky, actually. Everybody we work with is really, really keen on making sure their interview process is as good as it can be. And they always listen to advice that I've given from, you know, different projects I've worked on that's worked well in different ways. And also what I quite like and I do with pretty much all my clients actually is that we do bespoke interviews. So it depends on the person. So we have a rough process that things hang on, but we can change that depending on people.
That sounds fantastic. Hmm. And we've wondered a little bit. The last time we were hearing about your story about how you got into technology, you had just applied to MI5 and just applied to Google and they didn't even look at your applications.
No, right. How rubbish is that? I would have been amazing. Can you imagine me as a spy? I'd have been awesome.
I'm fairly sure that you went back and this whole recruitment thing is a cover. Where you just like,
yeah. It's all a great, yeah, it's all a great cover. I love it. Yeah. So no, yeah, exactly. I didn't get in. And so it's one thing I advise again with clients is to really don't do that. Like there are some really great people out there. I do think I could have added quite a lot of value to those companies.
So how'd you get in? You didn't get in at MI5, the fools, Google, whatever. What are they even doing these days? Where did you get in? How did things go?
So yeah, I was mentioning before I hooked up with a DJ friend of mine. So we were doing a lot of DJing online. He said, come and work in our startup. It was a company called upmystreet.com. It was pretty cool at the time. It was really good. They were hiring some amazing people. I was very lucky to work with at the time and even now some of the best people in the industry and was mentored and looked after. And the rest is kind of history, I suppose. I worked as a programmer for about 3 years in total. And then diversified into doing stuff like developer engagement work, and developer marketing for different companies. And then fell into recruitment from that. But I did unfortunately suffer from some of the fairly traditional female in technology things around, you know, language usage in front of me and the way that people kind of treated me as female and also finding out that I was underpaid by about $5,000 compared to my peers and people I was managing. So I came across quite a lot of that stuff, which is why I essentially left.
Under Yeah, underpaying different team members. I've talked to a lot of managers. And when I look for contracts or when I look for work, one of the things I like to ask is, what's the pay range for this position? Like other people working this role, what do they get paid? Don't give me names, just give me the range. Mm-hmm. And I'm always shocked by the number of managers who don't know what their reports make.
Mm. Yeah, pay is a really strange thing. People really don't like talking about it, and I'm not entirely sure why. I mean, one of the companies I was in before, we used to all, a company called Chimwag, I helped co-found a part of it with a guy called Sam Michelle. And so we used to put all our salaries and P&L up for all our staff to see. I mean, there's only about 10 of us in the company.
Yeah.
But we thought that was quite important so people could see that we weren't taking a huge amount more, but also that if people wanted to pay rise, they could just, and you know, they saw one of their peers who was being paid more, they could come and talk to us openly and we would explain why and then give them achievements to hit if they wanted to move on to another pay level.
Several contracts ago, I had a set budget for myself and to hire a small team for all of our salaries. And one thing I really liked is I went ahead and just split it into thirds.
Yeah, that's interesting. Have you heard of a company called Hypothesis?
I haven't.
Okay. Interesting. I can't remember quite what the URL is now. I was doing some work with them a couple of years ago and everybody in the company was paid the same.
I quite like this.
It's interesting, but I'm not convinced. It's an interesting model, but yeah, I don't know. I think people should be paid differently based on experience levels. And also to a certain extent based on what they bring back into a company. And also things like, you know, if you want to be doing part-time or remoting, then I think that's useful that you can have that option. Whereas I think that's really hard if everyone's just being paid the same you're expected to be in. Yeah, it can work, but I'm not convinced.
I think one of those things that's not suited for everything, but for me on a very small team doing developer relations, just saying, you know what, everybody gets paid the same.
Yeah.
Experimental and very freeing.
Yeah, I think that's really nice. There's another company I work with called Outlandish, who are amazing. They're a co-op in London, and they've taught me quite a lot about co-ops, actually. So again, everybody there makes pretty much, I think, within about £25, the same rate a day, and everybody they hire does the same rate. So everybody from developers, designers, and everything else. But they're really cool as well, because anything that they charge out to a client that is over the amount that those people's day rates are goes into a pot. Then they do social development on. So well worth having a look.
Oh, I might pester you for an introduction because this sounds massively interesting and I might want to bother them for an interview.
Yeah, and yeah, you should. They're great. And what was quite interesting is there's a whole network of these types of companies, well, like I say, partnerships and co-ops, that tech co-ops that run across the UK. And so, yeah, that was really interesting. I quite like that. And I went in on the same day rate as everybody else as well, on purpose when I was working with them.
Yeah.
Because it felt right. I couldn't really sell that otherwise. But it was quite a low day rate, interestingly, compared to market rate, or what people could get. But everybody who I spoke to that was not a blocker for, everybody loved it. Everybody was like happy to take a lower than average for them day rate in order to be a part of something where they felt like everyone else was being treated equally.
And I think the cost and benefit of not being miserable at work.
Mm.
For a lot of us, we'll chase and chase and chase the high salary and wake up one day and then just be like, wow, I'm miserable every day. What can I start looking for that isn't salary?
Yeah, I mean, the only flip side to that, being sort of devil's advocate a little bit, is once people get to a certain level of their own life, if they choose to have children, for example, or if they have relatives living abroad and they need a certain amount of money to be able to live their lifestyle, then it can be quite hard for people to take something less, or if they've got dependent partners, or if they've got, you know, parents that need looking after something. Yeah, that is quite hard, because sometimes I work with companies and they say, bloody hell, you know, I'm not paying somebody 75 grand a year. They can just bloody well have 60. And I say, well, you know, the thing is if they've been on 75 grand a year for the last 4 years, then it's very hard for them to make a drop. So there is an interesting, you know, people's circumstance, there is a certain amount of privilege in how much money you can and can't earn. So like, you know, if you're somebody with no dependents and you kind of live in a one-bed flat and you're really happy with your life and your only outgoings is a few video games and going out with your friends a couple of nights a week, then you can afford to take lower money. I always feel very privileged because I can afford to work for a few companies for free, like charities and stuff. because I'm lucky enough that the rest of my work pays for that. But not everyone can do that, and I'm aware of that.
And I think recognizing that, being able to command, at least on average compared to non-tech industries, a fairly decent salary is one of the big benefits behind getting into tech or staying in tech.
Oh, completely. Yeah. I actually wanted to be an artist before I went into technology. So my two great loves were painting and technology. But I was well aware that I'd make no money as an artist. I came into technology.
I initially got into technology because I just started a sort of marketing job with a startup and noticed all the programmers got paid twice as much.
Oh, yeah. Good
and
idea.
And I got paid on time, which, oh, startups.
Yeah. Also, I think there's a certain amount of kudos, isn't there, really, in being able to program. I miss being able to be introduced as, oh, you know, hey, this is Thayer, she's a programmer. Whereas these days it's like, oh, here's Thayer. And I often get introduced as a recruiter, which is like, oh no. So yeah, I miss the brownie points of being a programmer. That's for sure.
I think programming recruiter makes sense.
I'm not though. I haven't touched code in God, a decade now. If I touch code, something has gone seriously wrong. Yeah.
So if you were chatting to somebody, a mythical, hypothetical person who was sitting down with you without a degree, what kinds of things would you want to see from them instead of the degree to show that they were ready to start work as a programmer or start work as a technologist?
Yeah, sure. I mean, 100% private projects. So people who go out there and just build stuff and make their own things. You know, it doesn't take a huge amount of time. You know, if you spend maybe an hour a day or half an hour a day even and bump it up on the weekends, over a few months, you can make some quite interesting sort of applications and things. Something that's useful and real worldy, you know, like throw up some web apps that show you understand things like security, scalability, even in a small sense, things that show that you've thought about the user, anything at all that shows that you've learned to code, but also that you can put it together through your own passion and push on, but also anything that you don't quite understand to document it and talk about it quite openly with the companies that you're thinking of interviewing with, because nobody programs perfectly at all, right? Everybody's on Stack Overflow, everybody's Googling. What's really important is the ability to communicate about when you're stuck and how you think things through and how you think problems through. Nobody really minds if you think a problem through and you kind of get it wrong, so long as they can understand the thought processes you were using to get there. So don't see things that you don't understand as a fail point. Just more see them as a really interesting tool for opening up discussions with companies. That will really help them show how bright you are. I mean, that's a great way of getting in.
No, that's fantastic. So you'd like people to be able to bring you a couple of small side projects. Are there other things like portfolio sites you'd like to see people doing, attending meetups, speaking even? What can people do to sort of get out there and show off what they've made once they've made something?
Yeah, all of that stuff is good. But again, I worry a little bit because that tends to be people of a certain privilege when it comes to sort of time and money and also just personality type. I work with tons of developers who would hate to go out and talk to people. And it's really not that much of an important part of a programming job, actually. A certain type of developer, maybe, but the sort of standard developers that I would hire, the sort of the ones that make up the bulk of most teams, are actually often relatively introverted, quite enjoy spending time on their own. That's why they like computers, because they're not necessarily people. So I wouldn't put too much emphasis on that. I get quite nervous, actually, if clients ask me to look at things like GitHub accounts and how much people put in their own time.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and it doesn't actually happen. It hasn't happened for a long time. I don't think I've been asked to do that for about 5 years now. But for me, what you do in your real life is as important of what you do in your work life. And I'm always looking for work-life balances. If somebody's just coding the whole time, that's kind of okay, but it's not really a sort of culture I want to encourage. I would rather someone's out rock climbing or walking or tells me about their amazing, I don't know, origami session they do. Because to build great products and to have great developers, we need people that are rounded, useful, interesting individuals that live real lives, because we're building products for people who live real lives.
A lot of roles, when they advertise, the job descriptions will say educated to the degree level or equivalent. Do you have any advice for people who might want to apply for a job like that when they read these?
Yeah, I mean, there's two things, right? So my first thing is, why would you want to work there? I wouldn't. But I realize that's not very helpful. Apply anyway. Always apply anyway. even if you don't hit all the criteria, most people write job specs really badly. And what they do is they write them exhaustively. Like, this is our perfect person. If you've got all this stuff, you are perfect. And what that tends to do is it makes people who think they're perfect apply, even if they're not necessarily perfect. And that's when you tend to get a lot of sort of alpha people going into companies, and often a sausage fest. Whereas actually, if everybody just kind of took most specs with a pinch of salt and just applied anyway, if you're hitting around 70% of a spec, that company will want to hear from you. I can almost guarantee it. There are very few that sift exclusively on things like degrees, and they are the big ones like Google, Twitter, Facebook, etc. But I don't know if that's still the case. It certainly was 10 years ago. So yeah, it's always worth a try. For the sake of 20 minutes, just crack on and go in there. Or, you know, very happily explain to people, if there's a criteria you don't hit, like they say, we need 5 years experience and you've got four, then, you know, just explain and say, well, you know, I may have four, but I've actually done four amazing projects in that time, which I can talk you through.
And I think one thing I've also noticed is looking at job descriptions and how they're written. Oftentimes they tend to be sort of archaeological pieces. You've got a job description that somebody wrote 5 years ago and they've been tacking on bullet points ever since.
Yeah, that's very true.
I think it's oftentimes people don't go through and think about why they're asking for each of these points or even why they exist on the paper.
No, you're absolutely right. And again, something I do when I go in with clients is the first thing we do is revise and look over specs and check really just what the role should be doing and also where it fits into the org chart, because that's quite interesting. And I try and get clients to do, or anybody employing really, I always say that you should have a spec that covers a couple of things. One is absolutely essential. And they really are essential. Like literally you would not hire someone unless they had those things. And the others are nice to haves. And actually when you sit down with clients like that, it's amazing because almost 70% of the spec can be thrown out the window.
I always like to break it down by what do people need to be able to do on day one, those skills. What will they need to be able to do after onboarding? So after 3 months, we expect you to be able to blank. And what they hope you'll be able to do after 6 months and a year.
Yeah, that's...
And getting people to really think about it like that, I found is very, very...
I think that's really interesting. Yeah, I think that is probably for like juniors and mids, that's really good, isn't it?
Yeah. It's definitely for folks who are just getting into the industry or mid-level and working to expand a bit.
Yeah, that's lovely. Do you often recommend companies do handbooks as well?
I do, but I generally find when I chat to companies, they already have something and they're like moving it or changing it is a big thing.
Oh, interesting.
Someone who I really love for job descriptions is Zapier.
Okay.
And dear listener, will be all of the companies we've mentioned will be listing in the episode notes. Don't worry. And Zapier, right from the beginning, they talk about, here's why we're a great place to work. Here's our company code of conduct. Here's our non-discrimination policy. Oh, and by the way, here's our beautifully written job description. It's really well done.
That's so good. Yeah, I love that. I have seen some really great ways of onboarding people and really nice ways of doing job descriptions. I think the main thing, though, is that people just communicate really well. And that's something that I think everyone can get better at doing just as humans anyway, but it certainly comes through in the recruitment process. And even things like, say, going back to the degree asking thing, it's like, well, why does this person need a degree? Now I understand why a surgeon or a doctor might need a degree. And I can kind of understand why Google may want to sift on degrees if they're getting absolutely flooded and they have to put a line somewhere. But anybody else, you know, why? What's so important? If I give you somebody with a degree who's a worse developer than someone without a degree that's a better developer, are you seriously telling me you'd hire the person with a degree, you know?
When you ask people flat out, why are you asking for a degree here? What tends to be the responses to that?
They take it off.
Oh.
Yeah, most people are just like, oh, yeah, I don't know. So you're right about job specs being, like you say, almost like an archaeological piece in a way. But it's also that somebody somewhere had to write it, and fairly frequently it might be somebody either in HR or whose job isn't normally that thing. And so they quite like to be exhaustive. So it looks like they've done a good job in writing that thing. Cause, you know, going back kind of going, oh, here's just three bullet points. People may kind of go, well, you know, maybe you should spend a bit more time on this. But then you end up with this silly thing that lists all these things that you don't need. The other thing I've seen, which is terribly poisonous, and thankfully I've not seen it a huge amount, is when somebody who's in charge of hiring doesn't want to hire people that are necessarily better than them. So they will specifically write things.
Oh, that is such a thing.
Yeah, they'll specifically write things that are very hard for people to hit. And then even when they do, they will somehow make a reason as to why not to hire that person. I've seen that with tech tests as well. I've seen like this sort of incumbent developers create these absolutely bonkers tech tests that maybe in their right mind would either want to do or be able to achieve. And sometimes, you know, be banned from using computers to achieve. And you're just like, what? Do you want to hire this person or are you trying to put them off? You know, but they're kind of almost flexing their muscles and going, oh, well, I can do this. And it's like, oh, really?
As an aside, with bad interview practices, what do we think about coding on whiteboards?
I don't like it personally. I don't advise any companies to do that kind of thing. Nobody I've worked with does, thank goodness. I think there was one company recently who shall remain nameless, but I explained to them why that's quite hard for people with certain personality types. And they immediately changed what they did. So that was really cool.
I've always thought it's not a very good test of your skill or your ability to reason. It's just taking something you're potentially quite comfortable with and making you do it in a way that you don't like. A bit like asking someone to do a swimming test in a tuxedo.
Yeah, exactly. It's the whole tripping up thing again. I mean, some old school sort of vibes around interviews are that you should try and, you know, trip people up and make them fail. And then if they don't, then they pass. And I just don't subscribe to that model at all. I think, you know, you should encourage people and make it as easy for them as possible. I always say to every employer I'm working with that they should, even if they don't want to hire somebody or somebody fails their process, that person should go to the pub that night and tell all their friends how brilliant the process was and how much they wish they'd have got that job.
That's absolutely such a big thing. I've chatted to a couple of people about the cost of bad hiring and the cost of bad interviews, especially in niche industries. So in developer relations, if somebody has a hiring process where they don't get back to your CV in several weeks, or they have confrontational interviews, it's a small enough work community where everyone knows, oh, hey, don't go interview over there. They're jerks.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely a thing. Although, like I say, I'm pretty lucky. I work with really nice companies doing great things. So generally, they've already won that battle a long time ago. I don't work with companies that aren't making the world better. So already the sorts of people I'm working with are pretty nice humans, and they tend to design stuff quite nicely. So I'm quite lucky. I tend to avoid most of the awful banking kind of things.
It sounds as if you get to work with some really fantastic companies. If our dear listener wanted to get in touch with you, what's the best way to find out more about what you do, what Team Prime does, and what companies you're working with?
Well, hopefully there'll be a link, but we are team-prime.com. And I'm always very happy to talk to people about what I do. I've actually helped quite a few recruiters get started by teaching them different ways of how I've worked, but also I always help anybody who wants to work out salary negotiation or just wants some career advice anytime. You're welcome to get in touch. It's all free.
Actually, several years ago, you helped me negotiate my first big salary jump. And Woo-hoo! To this day, I owe you a pint for it.
That's okay. You owe me nothing. You know, it's just sometimes people know the answers. They just need to be pointed in the right direction. And yeah, it's really nice. A really nice part of this job is there's been, you know, I usually get maybe an email a week from somebody saying, hey, you probably don't remember me, but you got me this job and now I'm doing this thing. And I just want to say thank you because that job was amazing.
Aww.
So there are some really nice points about recruitment where, so I got an email about a month ago, maybe 2 months ago, from somebody who's working on, I think it was a LucasArts movie. Through like some of the graphical stuff. And I'd got them their first break about 10 years ago. And they were just like telling me, hey, you'll never guess what. Oh no, it was a Steven Spielberg movie. And they said, they'll never guess what. I'm currently now in Brazil and I'm doing this stuff. And it all goes back to that because no one else would, you know, talk to me and help me out because I was unplaceable. And I thought, oh, that's so nice. So I love that side of thing is really nice. Like when you're recruiting and you make a really lovely match between somebody who's just brilliant and a company that just really needs them and is lovely. It's just, you know, all the love. It's so nice. It's such a nice feeling.
Now that you've melted my icy little heart, do you have any sort of advice for folks without a degree, sort of takeaway advice to sort of wrap up with?
Yeah, I mean, the main thing is being proactive yourself with what you build, and always try and keep it to real world problem type stuff. Don't just do the sort of shopping cart checkout type things. I mean, I realize that's kind of real world, but try and think of a problem that's interesting to you and solve it. Or it could be a hobby or somebody's website or something that, you know, needs an actual real life working solution that shows you've taken requirements that you can work with other people. Quite often I just see people who've done exercises on certain platforms or programs that just show a kind of noddy task that, you know, build an insurance company's website, and they've got no interest in working in insurance anyway. They want to do something else. So keep it really real world. Don't give up. Always ask for advice. And if you're able to, and again, this is a bit of a privilege thing, but if you're able to, doing work for free for, you know, a couple of months, if you can, just on side projects and stuff with companies, just find companies that you love and that you would enjoy doing it with. But again, like I say, I'm aware that's a bit of a privileged thing, so it depends if people can. And just keep asking, you know, keep knocking on doors, keep emailing people, and not always HR people. Try and think about great developers that you like and have watched in conferences and drop them a note on Twitter. Ask to be mentored, all that kind of stuff. Just keep plugging away, really, and just keep finding things that you love, right? Because if you work in the area of things you love, then it's not as terrible as it can be, right? So life is never going to be super duper easy, especially if you don't have a degree and you're trying to break into a world that wants you to have one. But if you keep doing, like if you love cycling, then look at cycling websites, for example. Don't just go straight into banking or something. Just, yeah, stick with things you love and keep going.
Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.